It's a pleasure to see so many people here this afternoon, and those of you that know me know that I'm not necessarily the most excitable person. Maybe that's an understatement, but I am really excited this afternoon to be able to introduce Gil Peñaloza. Gil wouldn't know this, but I first saw him speak, well, it's got to be about 10 years ago now, at a, I can't remember if it was a Revolution conference or a Pro Walk, Pro Bike conference, but I'm kind of a transportation geek, dating back to before I got elected, and was really inspired back then in hearing the story of his work in Bogota many years ago, and continue to be inspired by his work. I think there are maybe 50 or so city staff here, which is great to see, 13 other community organizations at least, a number of other government agencies. Commissioner Charlie Zelli from MnDOT is here, along with other MnDOT staff, which is also wonderful. A bunch of folks from the private sector, so we got a great cross-section here this afternoon on relatively short notice. Glad you could all make it. Gil's been a great inspiration to us in St. Paul. As you all probably remember, he spoke to us at the Great River Gathering back in May of 2014. We responded as a city last year with a rare opportunity to make a major investment after we were able to buy down some debt on the River Center. A major investment in economic development, we've decided to spend practically all of the money on our 8 to 80 Vitality Initiative, which includes a lot of improvements across the city to biking and walking facilities, park spaces, and public spaces, which we are all really excited about, and the planning is underway intensively all over the place. The projects include what we're now calling the Capital City Bikeway, I understand. We had previously been referring to the downtown loop, and we are excited about that, as well as the Grand Rounds, improvements to Dickerman Park, and a ton of other improvements around the city that are going to help to turn our city into a more livable place for 8-year-olds, 8-year-olds, and everyone else in between. So we're thrilled to have Gil back in St. Paul. Briefly go through a little bit of his bio. Gil is the founder and chair of the board of the successful nonprofit organization 8 to 80 Cities. Yes, we stole the moniker. Sorry about that, Gil. Gil also works as an urban expert for the Danish firm Gehl Architects and serves on the board of directors of City Parks Alliance and the World Urban Parks Organization. He holds an MBA from UCLA's Anderson School of Management, where he recently was selected as one of the 100 most inspirational alumni in the school's history. In 2014, Gil received a honorary doctorate from the Faculty of Landscape Architecture and Urban Planning at the prominent University of Sweden. And that's really the short version of the bio, because I think we all want to hear Gil speak and not me. So I just want to say welcome to Gil Peñaloza. Thank you for being here.
It's such an honor to be here in this magnificent city that has taken to heart the 880 concept. Is this sound okay now? Okay. And I'm here invited by the Minneapolis Parks Foundation, but I was able to get an hour and a half into it to come to St. Paul. I love St. Paul. I was this morning at a session with the Minneapolis Parks Foundation that they had all of their funders. So I was trying to get the funders inspired around investing in parks. And then I was at a session at a radio station at the National Radio. And then I was on a 2-hour bike ride, wet like crazy. And then I stopped for a few minutes at the hotel to change and then put the hair dryer on the shoes to see if they would dry. But I'm here, and tonight I'm going to go to a session in the community. But I really wanted to be here. What happened with the lights?
I wanted people to be able to see your charming face.
Oh, no, don't, my face is not important. This is.
Just until you started, I feel bad that we made Russ read in the dark.
But. Yeah, it should have been the other way.
Okay, so you're ready?
Yeah, ready.
All right.
Oh, yeah, keep that one on so I don't want the people in the back to fall asleep. No, but I want you to think for a minute. Let's think. What if in St. Paul we could have the children with a park or a play space within walking distance? Every child. And as they not only they would have the parks within walking distance, but also they could go on their own, walking, cycling. And along the way, they could enjoy nature as a normal part of everyday life. What if the older adults could age in place? And we could combat issues like obesity doing activities that are normal. Not today, there are twice as many people living in cities that more people are dying of overweight than underweight. And we could also help treat mild cases of depression and anxiety. And we wouldn't have to spend $1 out of $4 on mobility because we would have parks and public spaces within walking distance. And we would have places where we would develop the sense of belonging and where we improve our concentration. And when they are well managed, they are safe, all ages, all abilities. And then we enjoy them with family and friends and children. We connect with nature. And not only children, but also moms and babies connect with nature and each other. What if? It's not a what if. It is totally doable. It is about parks and public places. And this is the event where I was this morning, the sunrise on the Mississippi. But it's Minneapolis, but it's St. Paul. We're going to work in St. Paul. And St. Paul, I love St. Paul many times. I've been and I've taken on bike rides with some people from St. Paul, some people from Minneapolis. And we were at the last year, the 17th sessions. They even had me at a comedy place. I don't know what the meaning of placemaking and public ground. But it was great with the Knight Foundation and with the wonderful Mayor Coleman. And when I came at that time, we spoke about placemaking and we spoke about mobility and parks. Today I'm going to be focusing a little bit more on parks than mobility, but everything is linked to everything. Then we can have a lot of questions and discussion about it. Because this is so fantastic, the possibilities that are in the Twin Cities, that is just magnificent. It's almost priceless when you go and enjoy it. So these are the topics that I'm going to be focusing today, but I'm going to be focusing mostly on equity and public health and walking, because those are the benefits of having great public spaces. That's the benefit of having parks. And I hope that parks get inspired, and each one of us, all of us have to be part of it. And the public spaces, the how everything is linked to everything, because it's not only about the parks, but the sidewalk and the street and the library and the school and everything that is public. But I'm going to put it into context. So first I'm going to talk about Bogota 880 and the perfect storm, and I'm going to end with a call to action. So Bogota, obviously I'm not talking about Bogota where I was the commissioner, because I think it's better than St. Paul. No, St. Paul is decades ahead of Bogota. But nevertheless, now I advise cities in many places, but before I enjoy much more to be doing what you guys are doing than to be advising others to do. And also, because it's not about the money. For example, in the first term, we did 2 metropolitan parks. We built, and also we built over 200 neighborhood parks. And one of the things that got me really ticked off is that, so a friend of mine said, oh, Gil, you know, parks and recreation, they are the clowns of the city. No one remembers they exist until there is a party, you know, the 4th of July, New Year's. And I got so upset because parks and public spaces and recreation is something that is 365 days of the year. So I started working on this, and we started working on this park. This was before in the heart of the city. The Pope went there, and then it became a fantastic park that is very, very well used. And we did sidewalks and bikeways and areas where people could run and bike and do all kinds of activities. The uses are so important, because I find that the cities, sometimes it's so much easier to find the millions to build the parks than to find the thousands to make them work. So we gotta focus on the uses and the activities almost as much or more than on the capital investment. And this is a park that is very successful, but I also love linear parks, because the linear parks connect rich areas and low areas. For example, this park is 20 miles across the city, And we started in one of the wealthiest parts of the city, and we had really nice wayfinding and areas where people could always separate in pedestrians and cyclists, and we kept going across the city. And we ended near the Rio, the Bogota River. This was before, and this was after creating a linear park all around and lots of these children's playgrounds. This was one of the poorest. But it's not only about these big parks or the linear parks, also the small parks, the neighborhood parks, in some of the poorest areas. I remember people saying, Gil, why are we investing in parks when there are so many poor people and there are so many needs? I said, if you really care about the poor people, when the poor people feel miserable, it's in the leisure time. So if we improve the quality of, if we improve how people use the leisure time in the low-income areas, what we're really improving is their quality of life. So that's why doing parks in the wealthy areas is nice, but in the poor areas is much nicer. It's even more important. It's even more relevant. And we gotta be able to make that happen. It really creates, and I love, I know that you have a very different park system than Minneapolis, and that Minneapolis has had this, because it's the nation's best park system. That is good, because then you don't want to be the second best. You're going to be the best, or maybe you're already the best. And it's great. St. Paul really has all the possibilities. And the nice thing is that it's a win-win. That rivalry that exists between Minneapolis and St. Paul, at the end of the day, it's a win-win. Because you know, one of the nice things when you compete between cities is that everybody can win. There doesn't have to be a loser. So it's nice to share ideas, as well as to share ideas with Portland and Copenhagen and other cities. You know, when you have, in the private sector, and you have a shampoo, in order to have a 1% market share more, someone else has to have a 1% market share less. So for you to win, someone has to lose. But if you improve the park system and the next door improves their park system, everybody wins. If you improve the bicycle facilities and the other one improves the bicycle, everybody wins. There is no loser. So helping each other and rivalry between each other is something that is great. But of course, this is not St. Paul. Look, most of the streets here didn't have pavement or things. And we did the ciclovia. What is the ciclovia? It's open streets. It's the world's largest pop-up park. It's magnificent. Actually, my idea came from Central Park. I was reading the biography of Frederick Olmsted, who did most of the nicest big parks in the US, when 160 years ago, he was talking that in New York, everybody hated everybody. The locals and the immigrants, the blacks and the white, the rich and the poor. But one thing that he felt is that people didn't know each other. Their children didn't go to the same school. They wouldn't go to the same doctor. They wouldn't go to the same restaurants. So he said, we need to create places where people can meet each other as equals. That's why the main motivation of Central Park. That's what's so beautiful about the public spaces, that we start meeting each other as equals. So then I said, you know what? Any city in the world can have a Central Park, at least from the point of view of social integration and physical activity. And then I said, you know, ciclovia, which is what we call it in North America, open streets. Simple concept. Open streets to the people, closing to the cars for a few hours a week, and we interconnected the whole city. It's nice to interconnect because people go if they are close by. It's not a drive-to facility. If they are within 10 minutes doing what? If they're going to walk, 10 minutes walk. Or if they are biking, 10 minutes bike. But if they're within 10 minutes, they go. If it's longer, they usually don't go. So that's why we had a little bit and we started extending, and now more than 70 miles every Sunday and holiday. But not everybody wanted to walk or bike. So along the route, aerobics and Tai Chi and cha-cha-cha and wall climbing and all kinds of activities. It is something that is great for anybody or any age. We get rich and poor and young and tall and fat and skinny. We get over 1.3 million people every Sunday of the year. And if it's sunny and nice day, we get 1.7 million. And many cities across the US are doing it. LA, who would have thought the city of angels, also the city of cars, and Mayor Garcetti, we're working very close with Mayor Garcetti. Now he committed to do it monthly. And the goal is to do it weekly. And of course, if you live in LA, you can do it monthly throughout the year. Okay, if you live in St. Paul, then you can do it monthly from May to September. But it's fine, we can do it May to September. Then we do something else from October to April. But this can be, and here he is with some of the counselors and other politicians, and getting, when we were making the announcement, and it's great, and of course, California, so this is the 80-year-old California. Great for business. You bring all of a sudden a business doing nothing, and you bring them 150,000 people in front of their door. It's something that is great. And many cities. So I'm really glad that now in the Twin Cities is moving forward. This is the mayor of Oakland and Berkeley. We went there to take a look at how San Francisco was doing it. And again, sharing ideas. San Francisco had it, Berkeley did not, Oakland did not. Now San Francisco has it, Berkeley has it, Oakland has it. Everybody learning from everybody. When New York were gonna do a lot of changes on the streets, such as these changes that, you know, they were saying it's dangerous for the cyclists, let's create an area that is safe. But before they did all of these changes, transforming Times Square and all of this, they said, okay, we're gonna do an open streets. So Janet Sarikhan, the Commissioner of Transportation, and Amanda Burden of Planning, they took a plane on a Friday night, they went to Bogota. Saturday, talk about what it is. Sunday, get on a bike. Sunday night, they go back to New York. They go in the New York Times, and they said, the idea is to make streets a heaven for walkers, cyclists, and others. And then they made it, Summer Streets in New York. Who would have thought? But the most iconic street, people don't want to go to some street isolated. The core of open streets have to be the most iconic street in the city. That's where people want to go, you know. Park Avenue, who would have thought? 8 lanes, Park Avenue. People walking and cycling and running. And then you gotta have other small streets so that you can get people from other neighborhoods into it. It's nice because you don't shut down the city. The big intersections stay open. By the way, some people say, oh, Gil, that's like a marathon. No, open streets has nothing to do with the marathon. I love marathons. And I love to run half marathons. And as my daughter says, Dad, what happened? Why didn't you do the whole thing? I said, I checked it already, I did twice. But when you do a marathon, you gotta be trained, you gotta be fit. When you go to an open street, you don't have to be fit. You can go for 10 minutes, you can go for 1 hour, you can go for 5 hours. Actually, when I was with Janet, she got a text from Adrian Benopi, the Commissioner of Parks, saying, you know, this is the most fun activity that has happened in New York in the last 40 years. Transportation doing the most fun. We gotta work together, parks and recreation and transportation and economic development and tourism and health and education and everybody, Park Avenue. We also did, in 3 years, 174 miles of protected bikeways. And we went from 28,000 people to almost 500,000 people cycling. And the key element is how to connect, how to interconnect people, and it's also critical, but we need to create a grid, otherwise people are not gonna use it. Look at the level of poverty. You couldn't, in your worst nightmare, you couldn't even imagine this. And how it transformed it. We do really nice sidewalks and bikeways. Why do we need to do nice? Because part of it is gonna be safer. But part of it is because we need to dignify walking and dignify cycling. And that is almost as important. So also because we gotta be consistent between what we say, what we think, what we say, and what we do. And when I'm talking about walking, I refer to anybody moving at the speed of the pedestrian. But now I'm based in Toronto, and I lead two organizations. I chair 880 Cities. By the way, that is, it's our website. We are an NGO, and lots of videos and documents and everything is free. And also I chair the World Urban Parks. And we hope that St. Paul becomes a member of the World Urban Parks. In the Twin Cities here in St. Paul, you are hosting so many events. Next year, the Children and Nature Network is gonna have their annual conference in St. Paul, in the riverfront. The year after that, City Parks Alliance, and we are almost closing an agreement between City Parks Alliance and the World Urban Parks so that it becomes an international event, and we will win people from all over the world so that we exchange ideas and people come to learn from the great things that you are doing. And I've had the privilege to work in more than 200 different cities in 6 continents. So, but everywhere people say, what is this 880 Cities? Some people think that there used to be a slash here and people used to say 8 to 80 cities. No, it's not 8 to 80, it's 880. And there is a big difference. Because it's not about, but 880 cities is not about walking or cycling as activities or parks or streets as places. It's about how can we create a St. Paul that is successful and vibrant. And we're going to have healthy communities. And people are going to live happier, enjoying their parks, their public places. And anytime when I'm in any city, anywhere, people always said, I might be doing keynotes or interactive presentations. People always say, Gil, can I send my children walking to the park or to the school? Can my grandparents ride their bike to get our eggs or milk? I say, you don't have to be a transportation engineer. Three steps, the 880 rule of thumb. Step number one, think of a child around 8 years old that you love. Once you have that boy or girl in mind, step number two, think of an older adult that you also love. And when you have the child and the older adult, then step number three, would you send them walking or cycling to the park or to the school or anywhere? And if you send them, would they feel safe? Well, if you would, it's because it's safe enough. If you would not, it's because it's not, and we gotta do it better. What if everything that we did in St. Paul, everything, had to be great for 880? Everything, the park, the sidewalk, the crosswalk, the street, the library, the community center. What if it had to be fantastic for an 8 and an 80-year-old? It's not 8 to 80. It's the 8 and the 80 as an indicator species. Because we want to have a St. Paul that is fantastic from 0 to over 100. So the 8 and the 80 is an indicator species. So if it was great for L, then we would have a city that is great from everybody, from 0 to over 100. We got to stop building the city as if people were 30-year-old and athletic. And we got to create great cities for all. That's the concept of 880 cities. But I know that we're moving towards we seem to be going through a perfect storm. And there are so many issues. We got climate change, and we see it on the news every day, worse and worse things. We got traffic congestion, and we got public health crisis, both physical and mental, economic crisis, and the population is growing. Everywhere around the world is growing. It's, you know, around the world. Today, we got 3.5 billion people living in cities. In 35 years, it's going to be 7 billion. What a great challenge, but also what a great opportunity to do it right. Because the population around the world is leveling off. Around 2050, 2060 is going to level off. So whatever we do or don't do in the next 30, 35 years, it's going to depend on how people live for hundreds of years, billions of people. And in the U.S., it's also growing. All of the forecasts in the U.S. show that the population in the next 35 years is going to grow by 100 million. 100 million people. That means that we're going to have to build around 40 million homes. Imagine you had a magic wand and we could redo a third of our city, even the best third. We would do it even better. That's the opportunity we have. We got to improve the city that we have today, but also we got to create great cities for these 100 million people in the U.S. Because the people are living in the cities everywhere. I mean, in the U.S. already more than 80% of the people live in the cities, but all of the growth and more is going to be into the cities. So what is the role of people like parks and recreation? I love parks, and we got to realize that it's not about being spectators. We can take a huge leadership. Also, we're living longer, much longer. It's what I call the new 65. Let's think for the people that have ever, in the history of humanity, lived to 65, half are alive today. Half. Amazing, isn't it? It's something that is totally new in so many ways. And what are they doing? It's not retirement. I say that is rehirement. They are doing so many other activities. They are painting, and they are volunteering, and they are traveling, and they are doing all kinds of things. And actually, one of the things that I find that our city should do much better is tap into these people that are retiring, are healthier and wealthier and more traveled and better educated. We should create an army of boomers. The other day in a university, so some millennials told me, oh, no, Gil, those boomers, they are so conservative. I said, conservative? They were the hippies of the 60s and 70s. They were the people that were so generous. We saw men on the streets marching for gender equality. We saw white people marching on the streets for racial equality. They were much more social conscious. So it would be so great. Let's get them into volunteer and be active. They got 30, 40 more years of life. This is the population pyramid today in the US, and this is what's going to be in 2050. So it's going to grow all ages, but especially above 60. This is the over 65. Look, in 1900, there were practically no people over 65 in the US, and how it's been growing. And today, in the next 35 years, we're going to quadruple the population over 85. This is the whole world. Each that is a country, and this is the population, the life expectancy. If we had been born 200 years ago, the life expectancy in the US was only 39. So many of us would be dead by now. Now, we double. Imagine, actually, all over the world, all the countries, 200 years ago, there was not a country in the world that had a life expectancy above 45. Today, we don't have a country that has a life expectancy below 45. And when we say that in the US we have doubled the life expectancy, we can say that we have learned how to survive. But with all of these issues, we must also admit that now we must learn how to live. And that's why we must take this challenge and make it an opportunity, because a lot of this is about the built environment. It's about the things that we are doing in St. Paul every day. And we gotta move fast, because sometimes we have so many urgent things today that we are like the little frog. That we focus on the urgent of today, and we forget about what's important for tomorrow. And since last time I spoke so much about mobility, I go back to my friends of Parks and Recreation, because we're not going to be observers. So what is the role that we can have in all of this? Are parks important? Are streets important? I'm not sure. I go to so many municipalities around the world, and I show them these kind of playgrounds or these sidewalks that are broken. And what do they tell me? They said, Gil, go do some fundraising. Not in St. Paul. In St. Paul, you create the 880 Vitality Fund. But in the other 99.9, they do some fundraising. But in the others, they see a pothole. They go crazy about the potholes, as if a car was going to fall there. And the media plays into this. This TV station hire a woman. All she does is goes and measure potholes and has a section on the 6 o'clock news twice a week. Twice a week. And the citizens, they get organized to pressure the politicians and the city staff on how to take care of the potholes. And finally, when they take care of the potholes, the engineers and elected officials and everybody goes to celebrate. So you say, what's wrong with this? When we know that the parks, that's where we develop a sense of belonging. That's where we make friends for children. Playing is learning. It helps the muscle strength, coordination, language, cognitive thinking. Whatever the park is, whatever the type. It can be just the course in Campus Martius in Detroit, or it can be some skate parks, or big parks like the one in Piedmont in Atlanta, or elevated like the Highland Park in New York. It's interesting with the skateboard parks, because people keep saying, oh, many cities don't want to do it because they think, oh, that's a passing fad. Well, it's been there for 40 years. And it's so nice. We see in some of the skateboard parks that I've seen are so great. But you know, the most important parts of a skateboard park are not really the loops or the angles or whatever, but are these two. One is how to get there. So bicycle parking. And second, this is critical. Nice, cozy place for the parents and the grandparents. And it's not only a skateboard park. When we do a playground, every playground should have in their budget an area for the parents or the grandparents. Otherwise, the grandparents, they bring the children, and in the summer they are very hot. In the fall or spring they are freezing. And then they want to go home 5 minutes later. But if they have a nice place where they can sit and chat and have a coffee, and read a book and make friends, they are the ones who are going to tell their kids or their grandkids, let's go to the park. So this is critical for any playground. So the parks are so important, any type of park. Some people have the Charles River in Boston, but you got the Mississippi River. And let's open up our minds about public spaces, because public spaces also include, they do all kinds of activities. I was in Chicago during the World Cup. The U.S. was playing. I went to Grand Park. And that's what people were doing in South Korea or in Bogota or in Germany. And it's not only about sports. Last year, the Umbrella Revolution in Hong Kong, where did they go? They went to the parks. And in New York, they occupy Wall Street. Or recently, Jesuit Charlie. You know, this is such an equalizer. You are here and everybody's the same. Rich, poor, tall, short, fat, skinny, everybody. That's one of the magic things of the park. This is Rio, 2 million people in Rio. But it wasn't during the World Cup. It was 3 months before the World Cup. It was when the Pope went there. And in many ways, this is what's going to look in a couple of weeks in the U.S. And it's not only about these big places. What about just some stairs? It's not also issues of a lot of money. It's about creativity. You got this wonderful river, but the access to the river is really poor in many areas. You put a nice stairs like this? Or how about putting a stair like this and then having a different family paint each one of these stairs and put their initials? Can you imagine the sense of belonging that that neighborhood is going to have on that stairway to the river? So, the parks. I want to talk a little bit about equity and public health, because those are some of the major benefits of the parks and the public spaces. Equity. Equity is so critical. We see what's happening in Ferguson and in Baltimore and everywhere. When we evaluate any city around the world, when we think about St. Paul and our city, let's evaluate, but how are we treating the most vulnerable citizens? The children, the older adults, the poor, and the handicapped. That is how we should evaluate ourselves. And in many cities in the world, it's not so good. So, for example, what if we had a goal? In St. Paul, every child is going to have a park or a play area within walking distance. Actually, this should be a goal for the whole world, but at least for the U.S., within a quarter of a mile. It's totally doable, and it's doable in 4 years. What if the next presidential candidate, whoever is elected, says, in the next 4 years, every American is going to have a park or a play area within walking distance. So that all of a sudden, we're going to see the magic of the kids and the butterfly everywhere. Then we go out and set up and build the parks. It's totally doable. Parks for the summer, parks in the winter. What if you don't have that park area? What if you have park deserts in some places? Let's think of the public spaces. What do we have if we don't have parks? We got sidewalks, we got streets, we got schools, we got libraries. New York. In the last administration, New York had many of these playgrounds with trust for public land, and they turned it into this. They increased by more than a third, more than 300 new playgrounds in the city without buying 1 inch of land. Taking this into this. We need to forget about the idea of having school parks, that the playground of the school is just a piece of pavement with a couple of basketball courts. Here, for example, they collect more than 700,000 gallons of water per year. And look at this beautiful green so that the kids learn the garden and then they learn where the tomatoes are coming from. And what if they don't have parks, they don't have schools? Well, they got streets. Take over the street permanently. The streets are our biggest public space. More than 20-25% of our city are streets. More than 80% of our public space are streets. So why don't we say, okay, in this neighborhood there are no parks or schools or libraries or any or faith groups that we can take. Okay, let's close down this street. Let's close it permanently on one side and let's put bollards and allow only the cars that live in the area to come in. And the rest we bring games and we make it a play area while we have time and money to develop a full park. And then we start taking over the streets. I mean, having a play area within a short time is a totally doable goal if we decide to do it. And if we have a play area, we got a park within every child, we're going to have it within walking distance of everybody. And then we come back to the 65. This is so important. The older adults is critical and it's so positive. 43 and 83. What is that? 43 is 43 million. The over 65 in the States today. And we're going to double it. We're going to double it in just 35 years. And our parks can play such a great role in all of this. And we got to think of geographical equity. We cannot accept that in our cities, in the wealthiest country of the world, we have places that within 8 miles, if you are born in this area, your life expectancy is 64. If you are born in this area, your life expectancy is 90. Can you imagine 26 years difference? And it's not Cleveland. You go to Washington, this is the same. You go to New Orleans, you go. It doesn't make any sense. And you go and on the ground, what does it look like? Their sidewalks are full of barriers or cracks. Their intersections are dangerous. They don't have parks, or if they have parks, they are in horrible condition. There are no grocery stores. There are only convenience stores. We need to change. When we're talking about equity, and people say, oh, no, it's because those people, these people are lazy. That's why they're not doing what? So this has to do with public health as well. And public health, we got to worry about both physical and mental health, because is this what the future looks like? The issue of obesity has so many problems of heart attack, respiratory problems, depression, anxiety. And then we start thinking, maybe if we say that the Asians or the Europeans are also getting fat, maybe we're not going to, no. Let's not worry so much about them. Here, 1 out of 3 people are obese. And if we don't do something about it, in 15 years, by 2030, it's going to be 44%. And people hear my accent, and then they say, oh, Gil, you were not born in the U.S. It's always been like this. No, it's not always been like this. 20 years ago, there was not a state in the U.S. that had more than 20%. Not one. Today, we don't have a state that has less than 20%. And then we say, oh, Gil, but in Minnesota, we're so much better than the rest of the country. Not really. We have increased by 2.5 times in the last 20 years, from 10% to almost 25%. So we got to work on this as working on a balance. We got to work on the calories in and the calories out. We got to improve the school lunches. But we also got to have farmers market all over the place, in the plazas, in the parks. In the schools, we got to rethink our school playground. We got to rethink our parks. How about having gardens so that all of a sudden the children, the community, they get into it? It's a new way of thinking. You know, if we do 30 minutes a day of physical activity, it's going to be good for so many things that the head of the CDC said physical activity is a wonder drug. And there is no one better than parks and recreation to do the link with physical activity. By the way, raise your hand, the people that are here that are from Parks and Recreation. Oh, a lot of you. So you see, I'm humble. You do such an important job. You are so important to the quality of life of everybody. And you do a great job. But I'm being selfish when I say that St. Paul has to do better. Because St. Paul and Minneapolis are pulling the rest of the country and the rest of the country, other countries, to do even better. So thank you for all you guys do. But also, I want to talk just briefly about walking. Because yesterday, the day before, I had breakfast with the America's doctor, with the Surgeon General. And we were talking about his new initiative of walking and walkable communities. And why is it so important to the parks people? I was having breakfast with him in Vegas because him and I were doing the opening keynotes to the National Parks and Recreation meeting. And I told the parks people, I said, you know, every visit to the park begins and ends by walking. So everybody has to be an activist around walking. What is the number one activity in any park, anywhere in the world? It's to walk. To walk. Actually, every trip begins and ends by walking. I don't see any cars in this room. I don't see any buses. So everybody came here walking. We might walk from the car, we might walk from the bicycle, from the bus, or we might walk from the places. But every trip begins and ends by walking. So we got to make it safe. That's how we are. That's how we are happy. When we walk, we use all our senses. All of a sudden, we're walking, and we see the children playing, and we hear the birds singing. And we're going from a coffee shop, and we smell the aroma. It's great. Just like the birds, they need to fly, not only to survive, but to be happy. Or the fish, they swim, and the deer, they run. People walk. People walk. Maybe the children in South Korea, or the ones in Atlanta. Everywhere, people walk. That's how we were created. In the summer or in the winter, we walk, but it's not safe. We gotta make it safe, which is why I love the 8-8 initiative of St. Paul. In the US, 76,000 people were hit by cars last year. In the last 10 years, over 47,000 have been killed. That's 16 times more people, more pedestrians are killed than everybody that has died in natural disasters. They're not accidents, they're incidents, because they could have been avoided. So walking is not a frivolity. Walking and cycling is not a joke. Walking and cycling is the only individual mode of mobility for most people. Walking and cycling is the only individual mode of mobility for all children and youth around the world. You might be the son or daughter of the wealthiest person in St. Paul. If you're under 16, your only individual mode of mobility is to walk or to bike. So walking and biking should be a right. The right to safe and enjoyable mobility. Unless you think that only the people that have the age and the money and the desire to drive a car have a right to individual mobility. That's why we're talking about democracy and human rights and equality and sustainability, and everything is linked to everything. But it's not only about walking. Let me talk a little bit more about sustainable mobility. Because in the US, 87% of the trips are done in motor vehicles. A city that is similar to St. Paul, Copenhagen, only 24% are in motor vehicles. How do they get around? They bike. They bike, 41%. In citywide, 65% in the downtown. In the US, less than 2%. A horrible mayor we had in Toronto used to say, the traffic in Toronto is horrible because of the cyclists. I said, you know, it's horrible is because there are not enough cyclists. Can you imagine if each one of these 41% cyclists were driving a car, what would the traffic jams look like? So it's about riding bicycles also. We gotta make it safe. And the people that ride bicycle is not just the 20 to 40 year old men in spandex. It's everybody, the little kid learning how to balance or the older adults on the trike. Starts to rain like today, no such thing as bad weather. You put on the gear and people ride the same way. And of course, we gotta link walking, cycling, transit. Public transit has to be better. We need to have the best public transit. You know, in St. Paul, if people that get around on cars are spending $1 out of $4 on mobility. So I find so many families that haven't gone on a vacation for 15, 18 years. And I go to their houses, and they got two cars in front of the house. They don't have money for retirement, for anything, to go to dinner with the family. What if there's nothing we could do that would improve more the quality of life than being able to downsize from two cars to one, or from one to zero? But for that, we got to have public transit, all kinds of public transit, whether it's the gondolas like Medellin, or it can be, you know, the buses. People have an issue with the buses. I was in Malmo last year, and I was talking with the mayor, and actually we're going with the people from the Knight Foundation and 20 cities again. And the mayor was telling me, oh, Gil, you see, people here had an issue with buses. So they put a nose on the bus, and they covered the wheels, and now it looked like a train. Sometimes it's psychological. Walking, cycling, and transit, they gotta be your friends. I'm not saying that this is the end of the car industry, but it's changing very rapidly. The young people in the US, the 16 through 24, purchased fewer cars in the last 2 years than any time in the last 40. Actually, even got fewer driver license. And now we got car sharing and electric cars and other modes. And also we're buying more and more through the internet, but we get it through deliveries. And these trucks are nice, but are not as nice doing door-to-door delivery. So what are they doing? They're hiring thousands of people on bicycles. so that the truck goes to one place, but the last 2 or 3 miles are done on bicycles. So it's how to make that linkage. And before, we used to say, if there's not enough space for public transit and cars, then only cars. But now if there's not enough space for public transit and cars, then only public transit. This is the future of St. Paul, having nice public transit and walking and cycling. So how do we improve this? Walking. Pedestrians got to be the priority, but they have not been the priority. This is how we've been building the cities. And this is like an insult to all the pedestrians. We're telling this woman every day, you are a second-class citizen. So we got to change all of this. And it's you know, and people say, oh, it's because of the winter. No, this is a horrible place without any sidewalks or in the winter, in the summer, any time of the year. We got to do better sidewalks. And we know how to do it. I mean, we have done it in so many places. It's not rocket science. These are not technical issues. Every year, 5 million people are injured while walking around the world. 270,000 people are killed. And if we're going to improve walkability, let's lower the speed below 20 miles an hour. All residential streets. All residential streets. So when you're on an arterial, it might be 30, 40, or 50. But when you're on a residential, 20. And it's not because 20 is plenty, sounds nice. But it's because if you get hit by a car at 20, there is 5% probability of being killed. If you get hit at 40, it's 80% or more. And there are many, many studies that show exactly the same thing. That's why many cities are changing the speed. I mean, we know in front of the schools, we put 20 miles an hour in front of the schools. Why? Because it works. But do we want children to be safe only in front of the school or everywhere? So we got to make it everywhere. And that's how we're going to have cities that are going to be safer for everybody. And it's not just about the school. It's about health and mobility and having business. And everything that I said about 20 miles also works for riding bicycles and having, obviously, priorities, such as this kid. But the two things that we need to have is have that and a greater protected bikeways. We need to have a greater, where the bikeways have a physical separation with the cars, or else it's not going to work. In Vancouver, there are many ways to do it. You go home on a Friday, you come back on a Monday, and you have the planters. So there are many different ways to separate. But if there's not a physical separation, the cars are not going to respect it. Sometimes we do what is hard. We go to city council and we approve, let's have a space for the cyclist. And then we paint a line. And then no one uses it. We need to enhance that line. Not just paint the line, but let's put at least a row of bollards. And then people are going to respect it. And then it's going to work. So we got to focus on creating a grid, a minimum grid. So one bikeway is not good enough. We need to have a grid that connects origins and destination. We've heard across the U.S., and that's what people are saying, men and women in the north, in the south, white, black, Hispanic. We need to create these grids. And then all of the sudden things start to click. Once we do the grid, then it clicks. It is, in many ways, like a power grid. We're not going to do a power grid in one neighborhood. We've got to do it citywide. And public transit, we've got to improve public transit. All of it. One of my brothers says, a developed city is not the one where the poor have cars, but is the one where the rich use public transit. And cities are doing changes. This is Buenos Aires that is broke. 2011, this was their main avenue. Then they created BRT. They took away 4 lanes of cars and they made it for public transit. And the mayor is running for president. The elections are next month and he might win. The other day, a mayor told me, Gil, now everybody's going to get out of their car because we bought these buses. I said, you think anyone is going to get out of their car when this is what the bus stop looks like? This is a school of 1,500 students, a high school, and this is the bus stop. So I decided to show this mayor another bus stop. He said, Gil, why are you showing me this bus stop? I said, because this is what the bus stop would look like if the decision makers use the bus service. We got to make it a better option. So why talk about this? Because of the benefits. This is going to be good. We're going to have cleaner air. We're going to improve mobility. It's going to be good for economic development. And it's going to be healthier. So I want to end just by taking you through 5 quick steps on how to change the how. How are we going to move from talking to doing? And focusing on the EARTH acronym, the environment, economic activity, recreation, transportation, and health. The 5 elements to change. First, a sense of urgency. We got to do it now. We see all of these issues. Second, we gotta have political will. where the general interest must prevail over the particular. Any discussion when you go to any public event is, what is the general interest? Oh, but I don't want to take my car, the car parking because of my business. No, don't tell me, because why shouldn't we take the car parking because it's the general interest? So all of the discussion around general interest. Third, we need doers. Each one of you gotta be a doer. Don't take no for an answer. Four, we need leadership, thousands of leaders in the schools, in the business, in the neighborhoods. And five, we need citizen engagement. The citizens are magnificent and try to decide what is it that they want. They don't know the how we invite the experts. But we need first to go and ask the citizens and listen honestly. Because otherwise we might just ask a couple of friends and all they wanna do yoga. Do yoga in the park. Do yoga in the Ross Kennedy Park in Boston, or do it in the waterfront of San Diego, or do it on East Park. And then we'll think everybody just wants to do yoga, which is not true. Some people want to sit around a fireplace. Others want to have pizza in the park. Others want to do painting. Others want to do all kinds of activities. In the summer, in the winter, when we ask the citizens, they give us hundreds of ideas. So these are the five elements. So let's keep in mind that this is not a technical issue, this is not a financial, this is political. That's why everybody has to get involved. And there's a great opportunity. Let's build some broad alliances. Let's get the elected officials and public sector staff and community. And elected officials, let's get municipal, state, federal. Let's get also the Board of Education, the public sector staff. Let's get parks and recreation and planning and transportation and education in the community. Also, let's get everybody, the activists, the media, the universities, everybody. How do we get all three together, moving in the same direction, elected officials, public sector staff, and community? By having a shared vision and a sense of urgency. So remember that at the beginning I showed you the Simon Bolivar Park, the Pope came here, gave a mass for 1 million people. Nothing happened in 27 years. The city put a wired fence and no one could go in. Why nothing happened? Because it's easier not to do anything. When you try to do things, it's hard. I'm sure that it happened the same. When you try to do things, some people show up that I call them the civic cadavers. Who are the civic cadavers? People that you thought they were dead because they haven't done anything good for the community in the last few years. But when you try to do something, they resuscitate. Not to support you, to oppose and to tell you, oh, you haven't heard the community. I'm here on behalf of the community. But you gotta remember that the citizens, they are paying us every other week is to get things done, not to find 20 excuses why things cannot be done. So each one of us has to become a champion at getting things done. And that's why nothing happened in 27 years. And then in 3 years, we turn it into this great park. So we must move from talking to doing. And keep always in mind that whatever we do in the city, in any of the departments of the city, in any area, is really about creating vibrant cities and healthy communities where all people are going to live happier. I wish you and support all the very, very best. Thank you. Are there any questions? Anybody? I know that I went 3 minutes over time, but we can take three questions. Anybody has any question? Okay. By the way, here we've got our website, and I can tweet. Yes?
Well, you said it wasn't technical and it wasn't about funding. So what? Those are oftentimes things that we hear over and over again, that is what it's about. So what is it about, and how do we overcome the hearing that it's technical and it's about funding?
Well, it's not technical because whatever we wanna do, someone is doing it somewhere around the world. So if we wanna turn a street that in the summer is paved and then in the winter is gonna be a skateboard, an ice skating rink, we can find 30, 40, 50 cities that are doing it. So we can find what it is. If we want to find do an ice skating, but for the summer, we know that now there's a new surface and how to do it. So the technical part is people know how to do a bikeway. People know how to make it safe for the pedestrian. For example, this morning when we were driving and we almost saw a woman being run over on an intersection. Very simple. A car was turning right and the woman was on the corner. And the person probably didn't see her. and almost ran over, and it was a huge fight. But the simple, many of these cities, they allow the green light for the pedestrian to have 5 second head start to the green light for the cars. So when you are driving, you don't know if the person is waiting for someone or the person is gonna cross. But if that person has a 5 second, either has gone all the way across or at least have gone halfway across, so it's much more visible when I'm turning. It's not back here, but it's right there in the middle. So doing things like that, lowering the speed limits. So that's technical. From the point of view of financial, well, some mayors tell me, oh, we don't have the money, but then I go and I see they are doing elevated highways. They are doing elevated intersections. No, there will always be many more needs than resources. So the thing is, how are we gonna position? I mentioned that I was doing the keynote at the National Parks and Recreation. I said, look, we need to stop coming here to complain that the politicians, they are so dumb they don't get it. I said, maybe we are the dumb that we don't get it, that we haven't been able to communicate why parks are important. For example, most cities, year after year, they're cutting the budget of parks and recreation. Year after year, they're increasing the budget of the police. Why? Because the police are so much better at asking for budget. They're going to say, you know, if you don't want any more dead people on the streets, you better increase my budget. Actually, that blackmail is what parks and recreation should be saying. City council, if you don't want more people dead, you should be increasing my budget. You need to have police up to a certain level. But above that, it's much more beneficial to invest in parks and recreation than to invest in police. Imagine if something is happening in your neighborhood, and you have been going to the neighborhood park, and you know your neighbors, you know everybody on the street. Something's happened on the street, you go out to help. You have developed a sense of solidarity. But if you don't know anybody on the street and something is happening, you close the doors and you stay inside. So that is what I mean by technical and by financial. Yes.
How do we help our elected officials, I'll be blunt, ignore the cadavers?
Well, elected officials that have the guts to ignore them. And there are many fantastic elected officials. Mm-hmm. Everything that people do is difficult. First, tell the elected officials, don't worry that some people don't agree. Change is hard. Change doesn't happen by consensus in St. Paul or anywhere else. Times Square was made pedestrian like 5 years ago. Still 28% of the people are against it. 72% of the people. But if some politician has said, oh, let's wait, there is some concern, there will always be concern. So let's help the elected officials realize that the general interest prevails over the particular. Let's go to the public meetings so that not only the civic cadavers go to the public meetings, but we need to get the people that are in favor. Sometimes the people that go to the public meetings are only the ones that are against projects. The ones that are for, they say, oh, it's going to happen anyway, so I'm not going. It's a lot easier for the elected official that is going to do a protected bike lane and is going to remove parking if he or she goes to a public meeting and there's a lot of people supporting the idea and a few against it, than if everybody in the public meeting is against it. So we need to get the people that are, citizens can no longer be spectators. The citizens need to participate. We need to realize sometimes it's much more important for our quality of life, the public realm of our neighborhood, than getting 10% more salary. We get 10% more salary and then we spend it in whatever and we almost forget. But having the park within walking distance, having the sidewalk, the crosswalk, having the school where we can use the facilities, all of that is gonna make us much happier and better quality of life. So we need to tell that to the citizens and we need to encourage. And for example, we need to encourage citizen groups, activism, that is good. Let's get more also so that when there is change of governments, there is no real changes in the key principles. So it's not that, oh, there's a new mayor, so everything is new. No, Mr. Mayor. Here, there are some strong citizen organizations that are gonna make sure that the vision that we have for our city is gonna continue. There might be different pieces of the puzzle, but the puzzle is gonna be the same. The vision is the same because it's a citizen-led vision. There are different pieces, and maybe to this mayor, this piece was more important, to the one is another, but as long as it's the pieces of the same puzzle. But if we get a new mayor, and all of a sudden, he brings a different puzzle and a different vision that has nothing to do, that's why we need to have a staff very well trained, but also the staff needs to help get citizen groups organized. Any last question? Well, I just want to thank you for everything that St. Paul is doing around 880 Vitality, because it is really a simple but a very powerful concept. When we say, you know, is this intersection safe or not? And you are doing so many great things, but and you're also taking to heart the idea there is not going to be a Martian coming down to fix our city. It's up to all of us, the elected officials and the city staff and the citizens, working together. This is like a three-legged stool. But none of the legs can be off. One is the elected officials, one is the public sector staff, and one is the citizens. All three legs need to work in sync. There might be differences, but then you sit down and you solve those differences, but you need to continue moving forward. So I wish you all the very best. Thank you.